गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, एम आई ऑडिबल? ओके, थैंक यू मनीष. सो इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी वर डिस्कसिंग आईपी प्रोटोकॉल हेडर फॉर्मेट. ओके, सो वी डिस्कस्ड IPv4 हेडर format, and in that there was a row which was about fragmentation. Yes, screen is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So there was a field which was about the fragmentation. Few things were left when we were discussing this thing now. So yeah, so here the identification field, then do not fragment, more fragment, and fragmentation offset. This thing was left and this checksum was left. So we will discuss these things today. Okay. So first is checksum. Checksum I have not covered in that error correction and that. There I'll teach again and I'll tell you how to calculate that. Okay. But for today, I would like to tell you that checksum is a total sum. You, whatever data you are sending, you add it together and send that sum to the receiver side. And at the receiver side, they will calculate the sum again and find out whether it is the same or not. Okay. And generally here, the ones complement is used. See, suppose I'm sending you value 50, total 1, 3, 5, some values I'm sending, and that is adding to the 50. So what I'll do, I'll send those values plus 50 also. Okay. So at the receiver side, what you have to do, you have to add those values again and then you have to compare it with the 50. And then if it is same, then you will feel that whatever I have transmitted is correct one. But if instead of 50, I send minus 50, then what you have to do, you don't have to extract like where is the checksum, where is the other part of the data, take other part of the data, add and compare it. You add everything. Add everything, whatever data I have sent plus the checksum I have sent minus 50. So when you will add everything, including the checksum, you will get zero. So if you are getting zero, it means the data which you have received is correct one. So that's why once complement is sent, rather than sending the addition of all those values, the once complement is sent. So at the receiver side, you add everything and the positive things and the negative thing, and you will get zero. Okay. So this is how it is done. You divide the whole data into the sections of n bit. Then in the checksum part, you put all zeros initially when you are adding all these things. Then add including those zeros of the checksum. So your sum will become of n bits. And then you complement that sum. Okay. So complement that sum and transmit that sum. So at the receiver side, the checksum which is received n bit is complement and all other are the positive values. You add together and you should get zero. Okay. So when you complement it again, your result should be zero. Okay. So if it is non-zero, you discard that value. Otherwise, you keep that value. So this is how the checksum is calculated. Okay. So this is like T is what you want to send. And the total of the T, the checksum you have sent as a minus T. So at the receiver side, when you will add both the things, you will get zero. And that's how you'll find out. So here the header is added. So this is header of IPv4. So first field is version. So version 4 you are sending. Minimum header length is 20 bytes. So you are right now, you are not using any option. You are adding 25. Okay. And then the service type, and then total length is 28. So 28 bit of data, 8 bytes of data you are transmitting. So all these values, and in the checksum field you put 0. Initially you put 0, and then take all these values, convert that those values into the binary, add all those values, you'll get the sum. Complement that sum, you'll get the checksum. Now, this complement of the sum you put in the checksum field and you transmit. And at the receiver side, again, the same process will be repeated and you should get the zero value there. So here, this is how it is done in the binary value. Is this clear? Samajh mein aa raha hai? How
मैम
the checksum is
एट
calculated?
रिसीवर साइड हाउ इट विल बी डिकोडेड?
At receiver side, you again add everything. You including the checksum also. So if I send 50, see my all values are adding to 50. And in the checksum, I have added minus 50. So when I'm going to add everything, all other values positive 50 and minus 50, I'm going to get zero. Okay. So this is in the binary way and this is in the hexadecimal way. Okay, this is how you convert into the hexa. And there is a procedure because the sum may exceed that. This you'll understand when I'll teach you the technique to calculate the checksum. Because see, if I have all values up to 7 only, okay. So I am transmitting 2, 3, 5, 6, 3, 4, like that. Some values I'm transmitting. So when I'm having value up to 7, I can use 3 bits only. But that sum is going to exceed. Sum can be 20, my sum can be 25, but I can't represent that into using 3 bits. So that calculation I have to do. I have to adjust. I have to wrap up the sum and then take complement. That I'm going to explain with example. Okay. How it is used at the receiver side. You just understand in the header format how it is done. So the checksum is added and it is transmitted. Okay. Now the is clear now? Or should I repeat something again?
क्लियर
Clear
है
na? Okay. Now the fragmentation part. Fragmentation part, as I told you, when we transmit the data is going to travel through multiple networks. Okay. We may be using Ethernet. Some when our data is passing through in between, there can be a token ring, there can be FDDI, there can be different networks. And so different networks have their different protocols, their minimum transfer unit size and everything they have. We call that as a MTU. Okay. Like that. So suppose IP packet of maximum size. So maximum size of my IP packet can be 65,536, including header. This I am transmitting, but my data has to be transmitted through network, which is Ethernet, and there it supports MTU size of 1500 bytes only. The maximum size of the frame can be 1500 bytes only. Then my data has to be divided into the small fragments of 1500 bytes. So this process we call it as a fragmentation. Okay. So in that fragmentation header, we have to divide that, and the maximum transfer unit what can pass through any network is known as MTU size. Okay. Then this IP protocol is prepared at the data is prepared at the network layer, and then it is transmitted to the network layer. It is given to the network layer. So layer put data link layer. So data link layer will add its own header, trailer, and fit that datagram, the data which we have sent from the network layer into that MTU size. Okay. So these are the different MTU size for different networks. So if your data is in through Hyperchain, it can pass 65,535 MTU size. Through token ring, it supports only 17,000. So if you are sending 65,000 data, so in the it should be divided 17,000, 17,000. In token ring, where the capacity is 4 Mbps, so the maximum MTU size is 4,464. Ethernet is 1500 bytes. X 2.5 is 576. Point to point triple P is 296. And any packet datagram, because every can pass through can take any route. All packets go through different routes, different networks. Get different networks, the can be printed more than one time. Okay, more than one time. At the destination side, all those packets are received together and reassembled together, and then it is transmitted. Okay, so this we call it as a fragmentation. This process of dividing the larger IP size packet into the small size fragments or small frames that it can pass through that network, we call it as a fragmentation. Okay, so in the fragmentation, to support this fragmentation, these are three fields in that IP here, if you remember: identification, then two flags, do not fragment, more fragment, and fragmentation. Okay, identification is a number which one particular pack. If your packet is to be added at the destination, how those excuse me, how those pieces will be identified that they packet. In the identification to identify that pack. Okay, activities
मैम
node fragment if yes
मैम योर वॉइस इज ब्रेकिंग।
my voice is breaking. Okay, actually
नाउ क्लियर मैम।
yeah now clear huh? हाँ okay actually I have network issue so I'm on the mobile data. I hope now it's audible now.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Now this do not fragment is when your data is passing through a smaller network and you don't want that your data should be divided. It should not be further divided. So that's why you can set this DF bit to 1. If you remember in yesterday's experiment, we saw there were many packets which were being transmitted, and this DF bit was set to 1. It means if that packet cannot pass through a network which is having lower MTU size, then that packet will be dropped there itself. Okay, but it will not be fragmented. Then another bit is more fragments. So if you divide that data into small fragments and then multiple fragments are passing, so if suppose there are four fragments, so first fragment, second fragment, third fragment, and fourth fragment, then this MF bit will be set to one for the first fragment. It means this is not the last fragment. More fragments are coming. Then for second fragment also, this MF bit will be set to one. Only for the last fragment, this bit will be set to zero. It means this is the last fragment. No more fragments are coming for this particular packet. And then this fragmentation offset. This is a 13-bit field, and it will tell you relative position of a particular fragment. So this is just to tell the starting byte, the first byte of that particular byte number of that particular fragment. So that byte number is divided by 8 to get this fragmentation offset. Okay. So see here, suppose in this example, this fragmentation example, we are transmitting 4,000 bytes in one packet. The total data which we are transmitting is of 4,000 bytes. So we are giving them number from byte 0 to byte 3,999. Okay, so the bytes are given number as 0 to 3,000. This byte number always starts from the zero. Okay, so we are giving from 0 to 3,399, and to calculate the fragment offset, the first byte is divided by 8. So if you see this in the yellow part, the offset, the byte 000 is divided by 8, and the fragmentation offset is set to zero. Okay, now this is to be divided into three fragments. Okay, and here you can say in one fragment we can have only 1400 bytes of the data. Okay, 1400 bytes of the data.
So in first fragment, we will put the data starting from byte 0 to byte 1399. That is the last byte number. And fragmentation offset for this first fragment will be 000. That is the first byte divided by 8. So fragmentation offset will be 0. Then second fragment, in that the byte starts from 14,000 to last byte is 2799. So you divide that 1400 by 8. So you will get value 175. So 175 is the fragmentation offset for the second fragment. Now the in the third fragment, our data byte starts from 2800 to 3999, the last byte number, whatever the data last was there. Okay, the remaining data we put into the third fragment. So you divide that 2800 by 8, so you'll get 350. So 350 is a fragmentation offset for this third fragment. This is how we calculate the fragmentation offset. So samajh mein aaya how we calculate the fragmentation offset? Just take the first byte. And always the fragment size we have to keep in such a way that total value, the total byte it is carrying should be divisible by 8. Okay. Always we have to take the fragment size in such a way that total bytes it's carrying should be divisible by 8. And last fragment can have the remaining bytes. Okay. But initial all fragments we should divide in such a way. Is this clear? Any doubt in this? How we calculate the fragmentation offset? Should I repeat something? Samajh mein aaya? Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay. Now you see here the same example. The same example, but when we are putting into the IP header. So in the IP header, you see first version, then header length, then service type, and then 4020 is 7 is the identification number for this packet. Okay, this is going to same for all fragments. So 14567 is the identification number for this packet. Then here 3 and divide the first byte with the 8. So you will get the 350 as a fragmentation offset. So that is the fragment number 3. So ye tino fragment kaisa kiya samajh mein aaya? Fragmentation offset kaise calculate kiya? MF bit kyun set kiya one se? Samajh mein aaya? Any doubt in this? Is this clear? Yes, no?
Yes.
Should I repeat? Okay. God. Okay. Now, this second fragment is passing. See, again, now every fragment we call that as a datagram, become independent. Again, all these datagrams can pass through different networks. Okay, so now this second fragment, second datagram is going to pass through a network where it supports only 800 bytes of the data. 800, the MTU size is 800 only. Okay, so in that case, it is further divided into two fragments. So here, the size will become, total length will become 820 because 20 byte ka header plus 800 bytes of data. The first byte in this we are going to put 1400, so divide by 8, the 175 is the fragmentation offset. And then in this we are putting the data bytes from 1400 to 2199. And then from the next fragment we are putting bytes from 2200 to 2799. So here you see the total length became 620 and you divide, you will get fragmentation offset as a 275. Okay, so this is further divided. Again, if it is passing through some network, each fragment or every each packet, datagram you call them as a. So if they are passing through that, that will be further divided. But this with this identification number, if you see this identification number 14567 is going to remain same in all fragments. How many fragments we are going to divide? Okay. Okay. So again, at the receiver side, all these will be reassembled and put together in the form of original datagram like this. Is this clear? This is a fragmentation part. Okay. Now this is an example. Okay. Here, in this packet, which is received, the mbit is set to 0. By looking at this mbit set to 0, can we identify this is the first fragment, last fragment, or the middle fragment? Can we find out that packet was fragmented? See, if mf bit is set to 0, it means definitely it is not the middle fragment, because if that this is a middle second to second last fragment, this mf bit will be set to 1 because more fragments will be coming. This mf bit can be 0 only for the original one. This mf bit was set to 0. Okay. And here in this, you see, in the last fragment, this MF bit is set to 0. So by looking at this M bit, we can only find out that this is not a middle fragment. Okay. And this is definitely not a first fragment, because if it is fragmented, then the first fragment will keep the value as a 1. So we can just find out the packet was fragmented or not. We don't know. We cannot find out. But definitely it is not the middle fragment. So this thing we can find out from this M bit. Now, in the second example here, this MF bit is set to 1. So, is this a first fragment, last fragment, or the middle fragment? And do you know if the packet was fragmented? Can you tell me the packet was fragmented or not? By looking at this M bit, can we find out?
Yes, ma'am.
Because if this MF bit is set to 1, it means the packet was fragmented. Okay. But it can be middle fragment. Definitely it is not the last fragment. It can be first fragment, or it can be middle fragment, or any other fragment. But definitely it is not the last fragment. Okay. Again, here this M bit is set to 1 and fragmentation offset value is 0. Now, can you tell me it is the first fragment, last fragment, or middle fragment? Yes, can
middle.
Anyone tell? Fragmentation offset is 0 and MF bit is set to 1. Can we tell it is a first, middle, or last? Definitely not last, because MF bit is set to 1. But it can be first or middle.
Middle.
If offset is 0 means, fragmentation offset is 0 means, when we'll get the fragmentation offset?
First
fragment, because when we divide the first byte, which is 0th byte, then only we'll get the fragmentation offset as a 0. Then it is a definitely first fragment. Okay. So now it is saying the fragment offset packet set value is set to 100. And the what is the number of the first byte? And do you know the last byte? If the fragmentation offset is 100, we get the fragmentation offset value by dividing the byte number by 8. So if we multiply that offset with the 8, we will get the byte number. So if we multiply 100 by 8, we will get the first byte is starting from the 800. Okay. And first byte number is 800. We cannot find out the last byte because we don't know the length. We don't know the total length, but we can definitely find out the first byte in this packet is starting from 800. In this value, you see, in this example, a packet has arrived in which offset value is 100, value of header length is 5, and value of total length field is 100. What is the number of first byte and last byte? Can anyone solve this? If you solve this, it means you have understood that IP header ka format. Can anyone tell the answer of this one? All values are given. Everything is given. Just take 2 minutes, think about it, and tell whether you can solve it or you can find out. I hope solution is not visible to you. Is it visible?
No, ma'am.
Okay. because this type of questions can be asked in the exam, even in the MCQs, even if you are going to give exam in the form of MCQ or subjective, then these type of questions can be asked, okay? Yes, is anyone able to get the answer? Is roosters. If I sit inside, I'm not getting range, and I'm sitting in the balcony. Yes, is anyone able to get the answer?
Trying, ma'am.
Yes, okay.
Header length, total length is fragmentation of it given. If header length is 5, then what will be the header length?
5 into 4, 20.
20, and the value of total length field is 100. It means 20 by the header. So 100 minus 20, 80, but total length is 100. So it means we are having 20 byte header. So 100 minus 20, 80 bytes of the data. So in this packet, we are transmitting 20 bytes of header and 80 bytes of the data. Now our offset value is 100. So you multiply that 100 by the 8. So your first byte is starting from 800 and you are transmitting 80 bytes of the data. So 800 to 880, that is going to be the data. So 8, okay, but the total bytes will be minus 1 because we are counting of 0. So the last byte number will be 7800. Clear? ये समझ में आया? Can we proceed? Any
Yes,
doubt in
ma'am.
This? Okay, very good. So now, in the IP layer, the network layer, these are the components, okay? So when it is receiving the data from the upper layer, there is a header adding module. So that will add the header, divide the segments received from the transport layer, convert them in the form of packet, add the header. Then it is given to the processing module. Okay, so the processing module takes, then it is given to the routing module. Okay, routing module is deciding the best path from which path it has to go. Okay, and for this, there is a routing table. So it will consult. So if I have to reach to me or at any other place, I have to find out all possible ways, all possible routes to reach there, and then I have to select the shortest path. Okay, I have to select the shortest path. So that depends on the, that information I'll take from the routing table, and that routing module will take care of that. So according to that routing module, it is decided that this packet should be given to which router, to the which next router it should be passed. And then depending on the next router or the next next network where we are passing this packet or this fragment, this datagram, the fragmentation module, it is handled to the fragmentation module. Okay, and this fragmentation module is in the in-between network also. Accordingly, and this fragmentation module will consult the MTU size, like what is the maximum transfer unit it can transmit. So accordingly, it will divide. And at the destination side, the same data is given to the reassembly module. It will take all the fragments and everything together and put everything together and give it to the upper layer. So all these are the modules which are working in the network layer at every router and at every host. Okay, now this was all about our IPv4. Now IPv6 is also there. Okay, we are using IPv6 address, so we are using IPv6 protocol also. Okay, so in IPv6 protocol there are certain improvements. What are the improvements? One is the larger addresses than the IPv4. In IPv4 we are having 32 bit size of the IP address. So excuse me. So the total number of addresses can be 2 raised to power 32 only. In IPv6 we are using 128 bit long address. So it means total IP addresses we can have 2 raised to power 128. So we can have a lot more addressing space or than IPv4. Then the header is simplified. It contains only 8 fields. In IPv4, we are having 13 fields. Okay. And those remaining 5 fields are there, but they are made optional. If you want to use, you use according to your application. Otherwise, no use. Then new options are also added to support additional functionality. Security is added for authentication and privacy. If you are sending something which is a confidential sort of thing, we can use this. We can opt for this authentication and privacy. And there are more services also provided to handle special or real-time multimedia traffic. So this is the IPv4 datagram, which is changed for IPv6. Version field is kept as it is. Header length field is removed because now header length is fixed 40 bytes. Okay. Header length is fixed to 40 bytes. In IPv4, we had header length from 20 to 60. Okay, 20 minimum, 60 maximum. So that's why header length field was required to tell exactly how much size of the header we are using. Now they have fixed the 40 bytes. So no need of this keeping header length field. Now this type of service is replaced by the flow label. This is the same thing. It is working in the same manner only. It will tell about that, how this, what type of service is going to provide it this to this packet. But the name is flow label. Then this total length is replaced with the payload length. Payload length. Payload we call it to the data. The data which is carried with the in the packet. So 40 byte of header is fixed and payload length is the data along with this header, how much data we are transmitting. So this total length is replaced with the payload length. This identification DF fragmentation offset is replaced by next header and payload extension header fragmentation in VSET. So that is given optional in this. So all this identification DF, MF and fragmentation offset is replaced by the next header and the payload extension header. Time to live field, TTL field is replaced by the hop limit. The same function, same, everything is same. Only the name is changed to hop limit. Instead of TTL, we call it as a hop limit. The protocol is replaced by the next header. So if you are using TCP, then you add the next header of TCP. If you are using UDP, then you add the next header of UDP. Okay, then header checksum is removed because it is reduced performance. So we are saying that data link layer and the transport layer, they are having their own checksum facility. So that's why we are not providing at the network layer. Okay, so all these fields are replaced or changed. And now this is the new IPv6 datagram format. Version Then after that, priority, according to the your data, you can set the priority. Then flow label is a service type. Payload length, the data, the header field is 40 byte fixed. So what amount of data you are transmitting with this? So that is a payload length. The next header is the next protocol or the upper layer protocol along with IP, which next protocol you are using. You're using TCP, UDP, ICMP or something like that. Hop limit is your TTL value. Then source address, destination, IP address. And after that, all those fields which are removed, for that, there are added these extension headers. So if you want to use any of those facility, you can add those extension headers and then call them as a payload extension headers. Okay. So this is the frame format of IPv6. कोई फील्ड जो समझ में नहीं आया इसका एनीथिंग इज दिस क्लियर सो नेक्स्ट इज दीज आर द फील्ड व्हिच आई हैव टोल्ड यू ओके सो दिस इज हाउ लाइक बेस हेडर 40 बाइट एंड अप टू 6535 का बाइट ऑफ डेटा वी कैन पुट एंड इफ यू वांट टू हैव सम एडिशनल फंक्शनैलिटी यू कैन पुट एक्सटेंशन हेडर्स ओके ऑप्शनल दीज आर ऑप्शनल प्लस द डेटा यू कैन पुट हियर Okay, so if you are putting the next header, if you are using the extension header, so if you are using IP header or this is IP header, TCP or some other additional functionality you are using, you put the next header and header length. Again, if you are using one more header, then you just put a link. This is like a link list. You just point out that to that point. So next header, header length. Again, if you are having next header, like this, you can put up to six headers additional if you want to support additional something. So those are known as extension headers. And these are different six types of extension headers which are available. First is hop by hop. It means this is for router information. So if you are moving from one router to another router, so you have to provide information for myself. So this is given to and source routing is when you have to tell the complete path. Agar mujhe yahan se Mahim jana hai, then I have to tell the complete path, go to the nearest station, the station name, from that station to that station, then that station to that station. So that complete path we have to tell. So that is a source routing we tell. So if I'm sending some packet in the network, I have to tell that from my router, it should go to this router R1 to the R2, then R3, like that. The complete path should be included into the header. Okay. Then fragmentation, if we are going to use fragment, then we can use as extension header of fragmentation. If we want to provide some authentication and a privacy, so that time we can use this authentication header. If we want to transmit our data in the encrypted format, then we can use this encrypted security payload header. And destination option, this is additional information if you want to provide for the destination. Okay, so this is hop by hop option header, this is a format. Then this is a source routing. Source routing means you are telling the all the address, like the first router ka address, second router ka address, third router ka address. So you see example of this. So from A to B, if you want to send something, okay, then we have to tell the complete path in this packet itself, that from A it should go to R1, then R1 it should go to R2, then R2 it should go to R3, and R3 to B. So this complete path we have to tell, and this destination, this R1, from A to R1. And after that, there are three more steps left. Then at this R1, this value destination will be changed to R2, and the two more will be left, R3 and B, like this. So this is, we call it a source routing. If you have to provide the complete path, or you want to fix that my packet should travel through this path only, it should not go by any other path, so that time we can use this source routing. Okay, fragmentation, same which we use there, fragmentation offset, more fragments are coming, fragmentation identification. Then authentication, if you want to use, then you have to provide security parameter index and authentication data. For encryption also, you have to provide which encryption algorithm you are using, what is the security parameter index and encrypted data. Okay. And this is IPv6 address, as we already know that this how this is presented. And in that IPv4, that size is 32, and in IPv6 the size is 128. Okay, so that's why the last 32 bytes is the IPv4 address. If you have to convert it to the IPv4 address, then last 32 bits are taken as the IPv4 address, and remaining all are set to zero, because if you are using IPv4, and if IPv6, then consider all bits. Okay, and then this is how we can abbreviate. We can remove all extra zeros. Simply we can write, and if there are multiple zeros, we can further abbreviate like this. Okay, so this abbreviation I already told you in that previous lecture. So this is the way how you can abbreviate it. But this type of abbreviation you can do only once. All these zeros now which we have removed, you can only use once. Then excuse me. If you are using classless, and there we have to tell the subnet mask. Subnet mask is the number of ones in the mask. So that we can put slash and that sub number of ones in the mask. Okay. So now the question is transition from IPv4 to IPv6. This is important. Okay. Still, all the systems, all the devices are not migrated to IPv6. Few devices are still on IPv4, few devices are using IPv6. So when we transmit the data, we don't know the destination is using IPv4 or IPv6. I'm using IPv4, the destination is on the IPv6. I'm using IPv4, destination is also on the IPv4, but my data has to pass through the network which is on the IPv6. So in that case, how those routers will understand if some router is configured according to IPv6, it will not understand the header of IPv4. And if router is working on IPv4, then it will not understand the header of IPv6. So how we transit from IPv4 to IPv6? So there are three methods, three strategies: dual stack, tunneling, and header translation. First is dual stack. You use both in your device. In every device, use both. You use IPv4 and use IPv6. Okay. So when we send something, if I want to send something to the google.com or something, so first we have to inquire the DNS inquiry. If you remember yesterday's experiment, we saw that DNS packets. So my query will go to that DNS and it will find out whether the destination is on IPv4. So accordingly, I can use working on four connections on IPv6 and IPv6. So then second is tunneling. That is used. Source is on IPv6, destination also on IPv6, but in between network through which my packet is going to pass, that is still working on the IPv4. So in that case, when the packet which is having IPv6 header will reach to a router which is connected to IPv4, then IPv ka header will be data. If it encapsulate my IPv6 and the payload in the IPv4 header, and the last router of the IPv4 region will remove the header. Okay, then it will be to the host in the form of IPv6 header and the data. So that is the second technique, tunneling. Third is header translation. Where header translation is required, my device is working on IPv6, but the destination is understanding only IPv4. Okay, so I will prepare a data, put it IPv4 ka header, and at the destination side, that IPv6 header will be converted into IPv4. Okay, so that conversion, the header translation, so the IPv6 ka header is translated into IPv4, IPv4 ka header is translated into IPv6. So that is techniques. These are the three techniques for transition, or for the different versions, IPv4 and IPv6. Is this clear? Samajh mein aa gaya ye? Any part to be
मैम
can
योर
go
वॉइस
go
इज
for the
ब्रेकिंग.
I am sitting in the balcony. Still, it is breaking. Now,
यस मैम नाउ क्लियर.
clear. अरे, I am sitting in the balcony, but I am getting lot of disturbance in the balcony. Some rooster, some other birds, some. Okay. So, if this is clear, then we can move to the next topic. Okay. So, IPv4, IPv6. Transitions from IPv4 to IPv6 is over. Okay. Okay. So, now, other than these, this IP protocol in IPv4, there are other protocols which are used for address mapping. We call them as a ARP, Address Resolution Protocol, RARP, Reverse Address Resolution Protocol, BOOTP, DHCP. These are four protocols are used for address mapping. Then error reporting, ICMP is used. And for multicasting, for grouping, we use IGMP. So ICMP is Internet Control Messages Protocol, and IGMP is Internet Group Messaging Managing Protocol. Okay. So these are used in IPv4. In IPv6, the ICMP v6 is used, and ICMP v6 is a combination of all the functionalities are added to the ICMP v6. So in IPv6, at the network layer, two protocols are only used, IPv6, ICMPv6. And in IPv4, total protocols which are used, IPv4, ICMP, IGMP, ARP, RARP, BOOTP, DHCP. Okay. Now, address mapping is required. Address mapping is to map IP address to the logical address, physical address, and physical to logical address. This is like your name and roll number. So I can address you in the combination of both only. If I know both your name and roll number, then only I can communicate. So if I know only one thing, I know your roll number, I have to ask your name. If I know your name, I have to ask your roll number. So same here, we need to know both the physical address, the MAC address, and the IP address. So even if the device is not knowing the IP address or the MAC address of the other machine, it has to ask. So that is known as address mapping. Okay. Yesterday, if you remember, I show you that ARP packets. Okay. So that machine is asking, like, who is this machine which is having this particular IP address? Okay. So sometimes what happened, the MAC address is fixed. Generally, it is implemented in the hardware. But if we change our NIC, so we'll get a new address, new physical address. That time the machine, the other machine will not be knowing our MAC address. Sometimes we change that every machine, some LAN like local talk, they change physical address every time when the computer is turned on. And sometimes a mobile device like laptop can use from one physical network to another physical network. So they change the addresses. So ARP is Address Resolution Protocol. It is asking for the MAC address for the particular IP address. So this machine is having list of IP addresses of all the machine, but it wants to communicate to that machine, but it doesn't know about the MAC address of that machine. So it will broadcast that request in the network, like, who is this IP address? Okay, 141.23.56.23. This message is received by everyone in the network. Only the machine which is having this IP address will reply that this is my MAC address. I am this machine, this is my IP, and this is my MAC address. Okay. This is like I ask you, who is roll number 23? Okay, so that I broadcasted in your class. Everybody listen that. But only the roll number 23 will respond that, ma'am, I am roll number 23 and this is my name. Okay. So this is ARP.
and the machine request is broadcast and reply is unicast. So this machine V will tell that this is my physical address. Okay, and this is the ARP packet header format. If you remember, we saw yesterday this thing. Okay, so hardware type, like we are using Ethernet or token ring, then what protocol type we are using, and then the hardware length, that if you are using Ethernet, so hardware address length, so that is we are using 48 bits. Protocol length, if you are using IPv4 or IPv6, so if you are using IPv4, so the size is 32 bits. So protocol is IPv4 or IPv6. Okay. Then operation, whether you are requesting or you are replying, then the sender ka MAC address, the sender ka IP address. Okay, then it will ask for the target ka hardware address. So hardware address, so we don't know. So it will put all zeros there. Okay, and then target ka IP address, and it is broadcasted. Okay, and then target will reply. Okay, this is how it is transmitted. It is encapsulated into the Ethernet frame format. Okay, ARP request and reply. Okay, so there can be four cases of ARP. The target address is in the same LAN. The target address can be a router in the another network. Then you will send that request to the router. Router will forward and find out. And then target address, IP address is in the IP datagram. Okay, so these are different four cases where you just transmit the this request and you get the reply. Okay, so ARP request is broadcast, ARP reply is unicast. So this is just an example, and this is how the packet is prepared. Okay, SR request. So this machine wants to know the IP address of this thing. So SR, the ARP request. Okay, this is Ethernet MAC address it is using. So 6 byte ka MAC address, 4 byte ka IPv4 address. It is a request. So it is sending that this is my MAC address, this is my IP. The destination MAC address it doesn't know, so it will put all zeros, and destination ka IP. It will broadcast, and this is how this B will reply. Okay. Then sometimes proxy routers are used. Proxy routers is like these machines which are in the subnetwork. These are not exposed to the outside world. So when this router or wants to know the IP address of the any machine which is inside the subnetwork, this proxy router will reply on behalf of those machines. It will give its own MAC address. Okay, so KC, it will say that this is my address. This is, you can send me the data here. So whatever data is received to this proxy router, then it will forward to these machines. So these are not exposed to the world. So proxy router will act on behalf of on those machines. Okay. And RARP is like, sometimes machine forgot its own IP address. How it can forget its own IP address? Sometimes machine is turned on. We are using diskless machines. We are using diskless machines also at some places. So in that case, when the machine is turned on, it can read its MAC address from the NIC card, but it doesn't know its IP address, but it has to communicate. It doesn't know its own IP address. So what it will say, that this is my physical address. Can you tell me what is my IP address? So it will request, it will send the request in the network. And the machines which are having the tables for corresponding IP and MAC address, so they will reply if they are having the entry in their own table. So they will reply, okay, this is your IP address. Okay. So that is RARP. Reverse address resolution. Okay, so ARP is about, you know IP address, you are looking for the MAC address. RARP is, you know MAC address, you are looking for the IP address. So the machine will tell, this is your IP address. Okay. Now instead of this ARP, RARP, this BOOTP is used. So in the BOOTP, there is a server which is storing all the MAC address and corresponding IP addresses, and any machine sends a request, that BOOTP server will reply. Okay. Sometimes that BOOTP server can be in another network. So there will be a relay agent in your network. Okay. So you send that request to relay agent. Relay agent will forward that request to that particular server. Okay. Because you can't send that information, because if you don't know the, within the local network, you can communicate based on the just MAC address. You don't need IP address. But if you are going outside the network, that time you need IP address. So without IP address, you cannot communicate. Even if you want to ask them, "Are, what is your IP address?" You need to send IP address of that destination. Okay. So that's why you just give it to the relay agent. So relay agent will convert that and frame format, put its own IP address, and then it will forward to the BOOTP server, which is on the another network. Okay. Then DHCP, the IP addresses, you know, every machine is having IP addresses. So those IP addresses can be provided statically and dynamically. In the statically, once the machines are configured, the administrator will provide that IP address and that address will be fixed. Okay. And DHCP is every time there is a pool of IP addresses which are available, and every time machine is turned on, the DHCP server will allocate that IP address from the free pool of IP addresses. And when machine is turned off, that address is returned to the pool of IP addresses. So that is a DHCP, Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. Okay. So it acts as a BOOTP, and it will bind that physical address to the IP address, and it will allocate the dynamic address to the your machine. Then ICMP. It is important. ICMP is important. When we were discussing IP, that time I told you it is unreliable protocol. Okay. It has the best availability protocol. Huh?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So I told you that IP is unreliable. It is not going to provide any sort of error correction and detection information. It is not going to provide any sort of acknowledgement. If your packet is lost, it is lost. You find out. But how can we find out? Like, how the user will find out? How the source machine will find out whether the packet is received or not received? There should be some mechanism that at least you come to know that your packet is lost. Some sort of error message data link layer provides, but that provides hope to hope. Transport layer provides, but only if you are using TCP. UDP will not provide. IP is best effort delivery protocol. But if it is dropping my packet, suppose that we put that TTL value to 64 and we couldn't reach the destination in the 64 hops. So that TTL value becomes zero. The packet is dropped. So at least inform the sender now that your packet is dropped. So he will retransmit that. But IP doesn't provide that service. That's why this ICMP is used along with IP. Okay. So if IP is dropping something somewhere, then ICMP will tell you, "Array, your packet was dropped." So when we use ping, na, we ping, if you remember the output of the ping, so there you will see ICMP data is sent. So that is an echo request reply. Okay. So echo request is like, I want to check whether I am connected to your machine or not. So I'll ping your machine. So when I ping your machine, that time your machine will reply. So for that, we use ICMP. ICMP is used for many other things also. So that is, we call it an Internet Control Message Protocol. So generally, it is used for error, for debugging, for message format. We are using this, okay? And this is a ICMP ka message type, like what type of message we are sending, what is the reason for this message, checksum, and rest of the header and the data section. Okay, this is a general format of ICMP. Okay, so ICMP reports error messages to the original source. IP will not report. ICMP will report. Okay, so these are five types of error reporting. First is destination unreachable. When you ping something, we get no destination unreachable. It means if that destination machine is not turned on, or that is not connected to the internet, that is not working, and you are trying to connect to that machine or trying to ping that machine, and the destination machine is unreachable. So it will reply with the destination unreachable. So that is a type 3. Then next is source quench. Source quench is like you are transmitting 20 packets per second, but the destination machine can handle only 10 packets per second. Okay. So when the buffer is full, after that, the destination machine will stop dropping your packets because the buffer is full and it cannot handle the packets which you are sending. So it will stop dropping. It will start dropping your packets. But IP will not provide you information. It will not tell you back that you slow down or your packets are being dropped. So ICMP will provide. It will say that the source is having source quench. Like there is a what we'll say, congestion in the network, or the source that the machine where you are sending is not able to handle your data, your packets are being dropped, you slow down. So that ICMP will provide. Then time exceeded. Time exceeded is of the TTL. I set the value of TTL 64. The 64 became zero, and my packet is still not reached to the destination. And then IP will drop my packet, and it is not going to tell. So that time, this ICMP will tell that your time is exceeded, like the TTL value became zero. Now you go and send again. Then parameter problem. If we send something and some parameter goes not correct in that IP header or in any header, then the packet will be dropped at the router. So then this ICMP will inform that there was some issue with your parameter, and you resend it. Then redirection. Sometimes what happens, I know that to reach to X, I know the way is through A to B, B to X. But now that X is moved from B to C, so there is another path. So when I send something for X via route A and B, the packet will be transmitted via C. But next, for the next time, this ICMP will be informed that now that the machine for which you are sending is not in the network B. Now it is in the network C. So that is a redirection. Okay. So these are different five types of error reporting. So this is how this is encapsulated. ICMP, IP. Okay. This is how it is encapsulated. This is a redirection. Now we transmitted something for B. B was previously here. Now we are sending it through via R1, R2, like that. So it will, this R1 will tell, this time I'm sending a message to B, but next time onwards you directly send to B or directly send this way. Okay. So that is a redirection message. Query message is like, we want to find out whether we are connected to the some machine. So we send ping. We ping. Ping is like, I see. Now also we are using this echo request and reply. I don't know whether I'm audible to you or not. So whenever I feel I have a doubt, I ask you people, am I audible? So you people say yes or no. Okay. So that is a way of confirming that whether we are connected. Are you able to listen to me? So that is a echo request and reply. So that is a ping. So you send something, if that machine replies, it means we are connected. If that machine is not replying, it means we are not connected to that machine. Okay. So that is echo request and reply. For that also, this ICMP is used. Then this timestamp request and reply. So I want to know the time, date and time of the destination machine to sync that, to sync the data transmission between my machine and the destination machine. So I can request the time and timestamp of the destination machine. Then address mask. I want to know the address and the subnet mask of that machine. Then this router solicitation and router advertisement. So any router which is turned on, it will advertise itself. It will tell, array, I am there. I am this router. This is my IP address and I am connected to this network. Like next time, if you want, you can send the data through me. And that is router advertisement. And sometimes we don't know which router is connected to that network. We can ask you like how to reach to that particular machine, to that particular destination. So that is router solicitation. So for that also, this ICMP is used. Okay. This is how this ICMP packet into IP data is encapsulated. So IP is must. If you want to send anything in the internet, for that you have to use IP header. Okay, along with IP, you can use ICMP, you can use TCP, you can use UDP, whatever depends on your requirement. Okay, and then this is how checksum is calculated. The checksum way, you know, for this, all the values are added together, and once complement is taken, and then that is added into the checksum field. Okay, now these are two tools which are used for debugging. One is ping, when we want to check whether we are connected or not, when we want to check the timestamp. And another is traceroute. Traceroute command also we have used. The traceroute, like if I know I have to reach to your machine, so what is the way to reach? What are the steps or what are the routers in between? So I can traceroute to you any domain name or IP address. The command will be traceroute space the IP address. So it will give me the maximum 30 hops, like from your machine to the request is going to this machine, then this to this router, then to this router, then to this router, like that. Okay. So this is generally output of that ping. So if you are doing ping to something, so 56, 84 bytes of the data, 64 bytes. So 56 byte ka data hai, plus usme we are adding 8 byte ka ICMP header, so the data become 64 ka byte. 64 byte mein we added 20 byte ka IP header, so data become 84 byte. So that's why original data we are sending 56 byte, plus 8 byte of ICMP header, plus 20 bytes of IP header. So total data 84 we are sending. Then ICMP sequence number, what is the time to leave value, how much time it took to reach there. Okay. And then this is a trace route. If I want to find out the path to B, so if I give command trace route A to B, it will tell host A to R1, R1 to R2, R2 to host B. So this is how it is going to give the output. This is how it is going to. So if you are tracing route to a particular domain name or to IP address, like from this, you go to this first, this router to this IP address, then to this IP address, then to this IP address. This is how you can reach to the destination header. So here it is using 38 byte data, 20 byte ka IP header, 8 byte ka UDP header, plus 10 byte ka data it is transmitting. Okay. So this type of output we will get maximum 30 hops. Okay. Maximum 30 hops. Okay, this IGMP is not one syllable. IGMP is generally used for this unicasting group management. Okay. This is not in our syllabus. That's all about your protocols of this network layer. Is this clear? Is this clear? Whatever we discussed?
Am I audible? Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Am I connected?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear. So, cool. Okay. So, any doubt till whatever we have discussed till now? Samajh mein aaya sabko? Yes. समझ में आ रहा है सबको या नहीं?
Yes, ma'am, समझे.
Slowly ये strength कम क्यों होती जा रही है? क्या हुआ? बच्चे थक गए पढ़ पढ़ के online पढ़ के? क्या हुआ? बहुत ज़्यादा हो रहा है classes, online classes. थक गई है सबकी? अच्छा. ओके. असाइनमेंट सबमिशन इज देयर. कौन से सब्जेक्ट का है भाई असाइनमेंट सबमिशन? सीओए. ओके. अभी तो सब बम्बार्डिंग होने वाला है, बहुत सारे सब सब्जेक्ट का असाइनमेंट मिलने वाला है. सब ये एक्सपेरिमेंट्स का सबमिशन डेडलाइन आने वाला है. सो जितना पॉसिबल हो रहा है जस्ट कंप्लीट करते रहो करते रहो करते रहो. डोंट कीप एनीथिंग पेंडिंग. ओके. बिकॉज अभी सभी सब्जेक्ट वाले देंगे, जैसे जैसे सिलेबस कंप्लीट होगा एवरीबॉडी विल गिव देयर असाइनमेंट्स, देन लैब असाइनमेंट्स, देन एक्सपेरिमेंट्स एंड ऑल दैट. ओके. सो आज का अटेंडेंस लेते हैं हम. यस. सीट नंबर वन
प्रेजेंट मैम.